if I can have the slides, please. What I will be talking about is the question why natural brains, being made out of such slow units, are or can be so extremely fast, and also why they are so extremely energy efficient, given the complexity of their organization and their performance. And the proposal will be that with the introduction of the neocortex in evolution, or with the invention of neocortex in evolution, a new computational principle entered the scene, which relies very much on computations in high-dimensional dynamic space, relying on nonlinear operations. So, that doesn't work. Yeah, something happened. Maybe it can even, but it doesn't advance. No, it doesn't work. Yeah, now it works, great. So obviously relations matter, because all composite objects are defined eventually by the specificity of the relations that define the relation among the components. So cognitive systems need very efficient mechanisms to detect, classify, and encode relations. And there are two different strategies in which that are applied in order to solve that task, at least in biological systems. There is the detection and encoding of relations by convergence in feed-forward architectures and the generation of conjunction-specific neurons. Or there is the formation of cell assemblies, in which case relations are defined by temporal coherence. Now, ultimately, in the nervous system, all relations will have to be defined by temporal contiguity. And the reason is that the learning rules that are applied in the nervous system, they all are tuned to precise, to the evaluation of precise temporal contiguity, as far as we know. So whenever relations have to be established, be they semantic relations or relations of conjunctions in statistical co-occurrence, they always have to be encoded in temporal domain, irrespective of their nature. Even contingencies that have to be established between information retrieved from memory and events in the outside world, they have to be made simultaneous at some stage of processing in order to be able to play with the known learning mechanisms of synaptic modifications. So, one way to implement, as I have already said, these conjunctions and detect relations is by anatomical convergence. And that is used in the simple three-layered Hopfield nets that have been around for decades now. And the same principle is actually used in the deep learning networks that are now explored in detail. But we have data from the neurobiology that suggests that additional strategies are implemented in brains. First of all, we find an unexpectedly dense interconnection pattern at all scales. And as far as we know, about 70% of all possible connections among the nodes are actually realized in the system as the cerebral cortex. We see a prevalence of reciprocal connections, which is lacking in these feed-forward artificial systems as well as in simple nervous systems. We have massive recurrent feedback connections from higher levels to lower levels. We have soft hierarchy, many areas processing in parallel. And we have exceedingly complex nonlinear dynamics if we look into those systems. And this is a message that we got from parallel recording in these systems. If one records from just one node, one sees an enormous amount of fluctuation and irregularity. But if one records from several nodes simultaneously, one sees that these are consistent, complex patterns. This is just an example to give you an impression of the connectome. This is a few areas in the monkey brain, these red dots, mainly the visual system and a few executive centers in the prefrontal cortex. And the white lines, they stand for massive reciprocal connections that interconnect those areas. And the the message is, if you are a neuron in one of these areas and you want to get to any other neuron in this brain, usually you can get there with one switching station or two, not more. So it's extremely densely connected. And the question is how relations are defined and encoded in such a highly distributed system. How are neurons that code for features of the same cognitive object identified as members of a functionally coherent assembly, in case of assembly coding, if it's not labeled line coding? And how can communication be restricted to selected senders and receivers? Because it's inconceivable that an individual neuron spreads its news through the 20,000 synaptic connections it has to all the other target neurons at the same time. There needs to be some selective routing of activity and information. Now, a likely strategy that I would like to propose is that semantic relations are eventually encoded in temporal relations. This is imposed by all learning rules, but I will give you some evidence that this is actually what happens. Now, if this were the case, it requires that the activity of the neurons be temporally structured, otherwise relations could not be defined in temporal space. And this has to occur on the fixed backbone of the anatomical connectome, because these connections cannot change on the fly, as one would require for the definition of ever-changing relations for the encoding, for example, of objects made out of different constellations of features. So there's a binding problem, and there is some supportive evidence that this temporal structuring does occur and that temporal continuity is used in order to associate what should be associated. First of all, there is now ample evidence that most microcircuits, wherever we look, have properties of relaxation oscillators. When excited, they tend to go into a damped oscillation. If reciprocally coupled, these oscillators, they will synchronize according to the Arnold-Tang regime. So the closer their preferred frequencies are, the easier they synchronize. And if they are strongly coupled, they synchronize more easily than if they are weakly coupled. So what do we see if we record from brains? We see oscillations in different frequency bands ranging from below 1 hertz all the way up to 200 hertz. We see synchronization and phase shifts in a very dynamic way. These variables can change within hundreds of milliseconds. And then we see interesting cross-frequency coupling. We see that higher frequency oscillators are phase-locked to lower frequency oscillators. So there's a great mix of dynamic properties. And for those who have never seen these response patterns, if one records from a bunch of neurons symbolized on the left side, one gets the cartoon on the right side, clusters of discharges of different cells that are synchronized, and the envelope of this activity is usually a fairly regular oscillatory fluctuation of voltages. And these phenomena can be seen in virtually all brain structures, in particular in the cortex, because of its recurrent coupling. If one records from distant sites in the brain, one can see that these oscillatory patterns can synchronize. And this synchronization is context and goal dependent. It is not simply a reflection of the fixed anatomical connectivity, as one can see in this case, for example. One and two stand for two receptive fields of neurons, in this case in the visual system, that are activated by a continuous object. In this case is a light bar. And the neurons in this case synchronize, as you see on the cross correlogram on the right side. It's a nice sinusoidal modulation. If the same neurons are activated by two different objects that move in opposite direction, they are still responsive because locally for them the stimulus is the same, but the activity is no longer synchronized. So if one were able to evaluate synchrony, one would be able to evaluate the relatedness of the two stimuli that have activated those two clusters of neurons. Now, the way in which oscillatory activity can be used in order to gate communication and change the gating very rapidly on the scale of milliseconds, essentially, is the following. If a cluster of neurons engages in an oscillatory patterning, take, for example, trace A, then at the peak of the oscillation, neurons are very susceptible to incoming input because they're close to firing level, and they can emit spikes. While in the troughs, they are virtually insensitive to incoming input because the membranes are shunted, So the excitatory potentials do not summate effectively, and neurons cannot emit impulses. So if you take groups A and B, who are made to oscillate in phase at the same frequency, these two neuron clusters, they can communicate because they talk to each other at the phases where they are susceptible to receive messages. While another cluster of neuron C that oscillates out of phase or with a certain phase angle to cluster A, they cannot communicate. And by changing phase angle, the communication can be switched on and off very, very rapidly. And there's evidence that this is actually utilized in the cerebral cortex for gating on-the-fly connections or communication between defined clusters of neurons. Now, there are a number of functions that are difficult to account for within the conventional framework of feed-forward processing in the brain. One is the ultra-fast access to the vast amount of stored memories. Usually when asked, have you ever encountered this or that, you can immediately say no, or yes, but I can't retrieve it at the moment. So one can explore this, the whole space of stored memories very, very quickly. Also, we now know that perception relies very much on a comparison of the actually available sensory evidence with stored priors that are stored in the network somewhere. Primates, humans, change the direction of gaze every 250 milliseconds, meaning that the sensory evidence that is collected changes every 250 milliseconds, has to be compared with the appropriate prior, and the result has to be made available within 250 milliseconds. This is a mind-boggling problem because the number of priors stored is close to infinite and can be retrieved so fast by neurons that are so slow. And so the implication is that somehow all the priors, they must coexist as latent options in some space and be retrievable with about equal latency irrespective of their nature. So the hypothesis I would like to propose is that this is only possible if these priors are stored in a very high dimensional representational space, and that such space can only be configured as a dynamic space. And the proposal is that recurrent networks are capable of providing the required high dimensionality of such a space. Now, the ensuing hypothesis is that hippocampus and neocortex, the only two structures in the brain that actually do have massively recurrent connections, are capable of solving such problems, both of storage and retrieval. And that this is the likely reason for the evolutionary success of cortical structures. The price one pays is the susceptibility to epilepsy, but that seems to be, that's a price that is apparently worth being paid. So what are the dynamics of recurrent networks? Why are they so interesting? First of all, they provide an extremely high dimensional state space. Then they exhibit fading memory due to reverberation in these recurrent circuits, which is very good for sequence processing. So one can superimpose of information because of this fading memory. They allow for parallel search and very fast matching with latent priors, and I will give you examples. They allow for the encoding of sequences, which is advantageous, and these are properties that are exploited by some schools of in artificial intelligence that use strategies of reservoir computing liquid state machines. The I don't have to go into detail, I guess. In these systems, the liquid is simulated by recurrent networks, essentially. And in their case, those are randomly coupled networks. But in the brain, things are very different and much more intelligent. The proposal I would like to make is that the cerebral cortex, in particular, its supragranular compartment, can be seen as a delayed coupled recurrent network in which the nodes are feature selective and they function as damped oscillators. So these are interesting nodes. It's not just integrate and fire neurons. And the priors about the natural scenes, so the stored knowledge in these networks, is stored in the weight distribution of the recurrent connections. We know that these recurrent connections are all possessing Hebbian synapses. They can change the synaptic gain according to temporal correlation rules. So here's an example, and this is a realistic cortical network. These are all established data. These colored dots are the nodes, call them columns. They are feature selective. They contain microcircuits that make them oscillate in a particular preferred frequency that is widely entrainable. They are coupled among each other through reciprocal connections, and those connections make up for most of the connections in the cerebral cortex. It's an extremely dense meshwork of connections. All of these connections have Hebbian synapses and are susceptible to modification according to a correlation rule. There is a spatial gradient in this connectivity. Nearest neighbors tend to be always connected, but as soon as greater distances have to be bridged, the connections become extremely sensitive to the feature preference of the columns that they are connecting. They connect preferentially neurons whose feature preferences are such that they have a high probability of being activated in temporal contiguity, because the respective features do tend to co-occur very frequently in the outer environment. So the statistical contingencies of the environment get mapped into the weight distributions of these lateral collateral connections, the recurrent connections. So what are the predictions following from this idea? One is that the high-dimensional resting activity should reflect the dynamic superposition of all the priors that are stored in this network. That stimuli which match these priors, call them predictions, induce low-dimensional substates, dynamic substates, like a brief episode of synchronized oscillations, and that these substates are easy to be classified, and they are equivalent to the sparse code of a result of this matching operation. And then that this result state induces synaptic modifications itself, because it's coherent, it's low dimensional, and therefore can be used for the updating of priors, and also it's propagated forward easily because it's synchronized. So can these hypotheses be tested? Yes, they can be tested. What one does is one records from many nodes simultaneously in such a network, presents stimulus sequences, and then sees whether one can retrieve stimulus-specific information in the high-dimensional response vectors using machine learning techniques, simple linear classifiers. So this is how it goes. One implants a matrix of electrodes in the cortex of an animal, shows, in this case was the visual cortex, a sequence of stimuli, in this case are letters over the receptive field of these neurons. In this case, I think we have 50 point processes, 50 responses of 50 neurons. We convolve them with a sawtooth function to make a continuous function, and then ask a linear classifier whether at a certain moment in time it could identify from this high-dimensional vector what the stimulus was. After a training sequence where one used a training set of real data to tune up the machine. And then the finding is, and if you just look at the blue curve here, that after the presentation of a stimulus, A or C, classifiers can, from the activity that remains after the end of the stimulus in the network, up to a second what the stimulus was, whether it was an A or a B. So the network has a memory, and the substate that is generated is classifiable very easily with very high reliability. One can also show two stimuli in a sequence and find that in the response to the second stimulus, it's where the C is more or less, you see the blue curve go up again, one can find out what the first stimulus was. So the information about the first stimulus survives the responses to the second stimulus. There's superimposition of information in these networks. And at a particular moment in time, if you look at the green curve, in this graph, one can find out what the first stimulus was and what the second stimulus was from the responses to the third stimulus. So information about subsequent stimuli can be superimposed and retrieved selectively with the right sequence order from the high-dimensional vector of these multi-unit activities. So the summary from this is information is distributed across many neurons because they were selected at random. The information is distributed. The network has fading memory. Information can persist across stimuli. So a newly arriving stimulus is not erasing the information on the previous stimulus. Information can therefore be superimposed. And sequence order is preserved. So it's an XOR operation, which means the network does a non-linear operation because the classifier was a linear. So this is all fine, but to really test it, further predictions have to be fulfilled. One important prediction is that the recurrent connection should undergo Hebbian modifications in order to store feature correlations of frequently occurring stimuli. This is required for the acquisition and the updating of priors. Now, as I already said, developmental studies provide a lot of evidence that the weight distribution of these recurrent connections is actually reproducing very precisely the statistical contingencies of features in the natural world. If one manipulates early experience, one manipulates the weight distributions of these connections. One can show this. I have no time to go into that. But one can also use the ongoing experiment to test such predictions, because it would say if particular stimuli are presented very often during the experiment, then classifiability should get better and better and better because the network adapts to the statistics of the experienced stimuli. And this can be done easily by just subdividing the experiment in two segments, an early phase and a late phase. And these curves show the classification performance of the machine classifier after stimulus presentation. And you see by comparing the blue line, which corresponds to early trials in the experiment, and the red one, which corresponds to late phases of the experiment, where the animal has seen much more of the same figures, the classification actually improves. And there's another noteworthy phenomenon here. The stimulus is presented at T0. You have these vertical lines. They're not nicely visible. But interestingly enough, this is the phase where there are strong neuronal responses to the pattern, but classification is very poor at that moment in time. 100 milliseconds later, when the activity has already decayed a lot, but the network had the chance to reorganize, to self-organize its vectors, classification gets much better, suggesting that the knowledge stored in the network connections is used in order to create low-dimensional substates that are easily classifiable. So there is some computation occurring from stimulus onset to the point where the classification is very good that relies on this recurrent connectivity. The reason why classification gets better is that in principal component space, if you look at these colored dots, they represent the various principal components of three different stimuli. As time goes on, these principal components segregate in N space. And this segregation gets better in late phases of the experiment because of the learning that takes place. Now, one prediction that follows from this learning phenomenon is that if these priors actually get stored in the network by experience, and if they are in the weight distributions, they should be replayed during spontaneous activity. The network should know about those things. And one can easily test this by training a classifier to recognize the vectors. In this case, we actually made the classifier reproduce the pixel brightness of the pattern, so it was easier for us to look at the screening when we had the classifier wander over spontaneous activity when the monkey was doing nothing. And it turned out that yes, after the animal had seen certain patterns frequently, like the one and the E, in bouts of activity that are only 50 milliseconds long, the classifier can recognize the patterns that the monkey had seen before. We don't know yet in which regularity it replays it, whether there is some systematicity, but the fact is that every now and then, in spontaneous activity, within very short windows of time, the network reproduces the state vector that is characteristic for one of these experience patterns. So, let me show one more and then conclude. One prediction resulting from this is that since our animals have been living in a normal world, if we show them natural pictures that contain the statistics of the natural world as compared to face scrambled pictures that have the same energy but do not match the stored priors, then in this case, classification should be much better for the natural images, for the vectors that are generated by natural images, because they can exploit the priors that are stored, than their phase scrambled counterparts. And this is what one sees if you just concentrate on the right panel. The green is the classification performance for natural images, and the blue is the classification performance for the same pictures but phase scrambled. So same energy but broken statistic contingencies. So taking this evidence together and others that I couldn't present you, namely that when the system converges into a state that is easily classifiable, it converges into a low-dimensional state that is characterized by a brief burst of oscillations in the frequency range of 40 to 60 hertz. We call them gamma frequencies. So there's a descent from the high-dimensional spontaneous activity that is constrained by the sensory evidence that is made available, that makes the network converge into a low-dimensional state, which then can be very nicely classified. This all occurs within 250 milliseconds, and my proposal is that this is one of the reasons why this system can be so extremely fast, despite the enormous space of stored priors that has to be explored. And I think this is a principle that is very different from the principle that is applied in deep learning systems, even though there was a recent paper in Nature from the London group where it has been shown that it is advantageous. If one has the deep learning architecture, which is essentially a feed-forward learning architecture using backpropagation to adjust the weights, if one couples this with a recurrent network that has these associative abilities in order to replace, I think, what they called attentional mechanisms that economizes the search process in an externalized storage device. So I guess that by combining these two tricks, one that nature has developed relatively late in evolution, and the one that nature had very early on in evolution, because all these simple nervous systems, simple sensory systems, they actually use the deep learning algorithm. They are virtually identical. But with the advent of neocortex and hippocampus, a new principle, I think, has emerged that relies on coding in high-dimensional dynamic state space. So, thank you.